In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The evangelist Luke returns us this morning to the topic of prayer because it is very dear to him, and it should be very dear to all Christians. Prayer is a great gift of God and one of the solaces of the Christian life. Just as we heard last week, after the healing of the 10 lepers, after baptism, we are not immediately snatched up out of this world and into the heavenly kingdom. As the lepers were not healed instantly, but instead had to travel to the holy city a little while longer with their disease, so we also must sojourn here a while with our sinful flesh yet clinging to us. It is true that we have already been made citizens of the kingdom of God by his proclamation. We have been given the forgiveness of sins and the promise of eternal life and the inheritance that belongs to Christ. And we begin even now to partake of that kingdom of grace as the Holy Spirit descends upon us and makes us new. And yet, between our rebirth of water in the Spirit and our earthly death when we are taken to be with Christ, we must for a while sojourn in this world, in this foreign land that we know is not our true home. Prayer, along with the means of grace, are given to us by God for this journey. God does not leave us to our own devices. He does not force us to make this journey on our own strength, by our own power, but instead he upholds us and strengthens us along the way. This is for the reason that from our birth to our natural death, we might both reach the heavenly kingdom and be ambassadors to this sin-darkened world. His word is a lamp unto our feet so that we see the path laid before us, and so that we may not stray from the narrow road, but instead cross to the gates of life. Paul says, all scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. And so it is that the word equips us for this life of faith. First, it holds constantly before our eyes Jesus Christ, who is the way, the truth, and the life, who himself is the door to the Father. If we abide in him, if we dwell in his forgiveness, we are never lost, but will surely make it home. Hardship and suffering do not deter us from this path, and death does not frighten us, because we know that this path is the very path upon which Christ our Savior himself has trod. His hardship, his hunger, his suffering, by the words and hands of men, his crucifixion and death marks the way to the resurrection and life. And so it is for us that the word reveals that death is but a shadow scattered by the light of Christ. And the hardships we suffer, that we endure, are light, momentary afflictions preparing us for the eternal weight of glory, beyond all comparison. The word reproves, it rebukes, it exhorts, with all complete patience and teaching. It reveals the stumbling blocks that are placed on our path by the devil, the world, and our sinful nature, and it makes apparent their lies. The world says that gender is a spectrum and a journey of self-discovery. When a man or woman trips over that stone and starts that journey, immediately they find themselves wandering off the narrow path into the haze of the world's uncertainty and darkness. There is nothing certain, nothing sure, only fluidity. They turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths of the most absurd kind. But the word reveals the lie and says, male and female, he created them. It reveals and patiently teaches that gender is a gift from God. It is not something to be discovered, but it is a given. Men and women were given certain identities, To be sure, these identities are secondary to that identity as a child of God. But it is an identity nonetheless that comes with certain duties and certain responsibilities. The word exhorts us to understand that gender is not something to be discovered, but lived into. The devil teaches us that children are a burden to be avoided, a self-sacrifice only worth it if it fits into our self-chosen lifestyle. We too often have itching ears that accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions, whether it be the passion of unrestrained sexual desire, or passion for worldly glory, or the passion of sinful sloth. We believe the teachers who tell us that children are a burden to be put off by the power of pharmaceuticals and freely cast off by murder. Dark indeed is the path that requires mothers and fathers to kill their own children on the altar of their own selfish desires. Sharp is that stumbling block, but the word of God reproves, rebukes, and exhorts, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it. It teaches that it is the Lord who opens and closes the womb. And behold, children are a heritage from the Lord, the fruit of the womb his reward. For Christians, to receive children from the hand of God and sacrificially care for them, for Christians to bring them up in the truth, for Christians to make their children acquainted with the sacred writings which are able to make them wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus, is what it means in the broad sense to bear the image of God. God brings forth many children through the waters of holy baptism, through his own sacrificial life and death. And so we are called to bring forth children. As we journey along the narrow path, the stumbling blocks are many, the adversary is great, and the path to destruction is wide and broad. And yet the word illumines our path. It lights the way so that we can see those stumbling blocks from a mile away. When we have stumbled, when we have strayed from the path, the light of Christ beckons us back. Our shepherd lights his lamp and searches us out. He forgives our sins and returns us to the path he trod, the path that leads through his cross to eternal life. And in so doing, the light of the word abides in us, guides our path, and shines through us so that Jesus says that you, Christian, are the light of the world. By demonstrating God's forgiveness as we journey through this world and living according to his law, the light of the word shines through you, through the darkness, and calls others to join us upon the narrow road. The word lightens our path, and so also the Lord feeds us and sustains us on our journey. When the 4,000 were gathered around Jesus in the wilderness, our Lord said, I have compassion on the crowd, because they have been with me now 3 days and have nothing to eat. I am unwilling to send them away hungry, lest they faint on the way. Our Lord has the same compassion on you and does not send us hungry, lest we faint on the way. Instead, he richly and regularly provides us with a feast of his very body and his very blood for the forgiveness of sins, so that we might be renewed on the journey and have the assurance that he is with us until the end of the age. His body and his blood is that meal which regularly strengthens us as we journey along the narrow path in this sin-darkened world. It continually heals us from our infirmity so that we do not faint along the way. Through the supper, he upholds us so that we might journey with him in the heavenly kingdom. He gives us his word and he gives us his supper to guide and carry us from our baptism to our earthly death, which has been transformed by baptism into the gate of life. And so also he gives us the gift of prayer, the assurance that our Heavenly Father hears our cries along the way and is not blind to our plight. Our Lord Jesus tells us this parable, the parable of the judge and the widow, so that we ought always to pray and not lose heart. The meaning of the parable is simple and a great and glorious assurance for us Christians, who are the dear elect chosen children of God, chosen before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. There is an unjust judge, a wicked man who is the very definition of a reprobate sinner, who self-consciously neither fears God nor man. He is a powerful man and completely and totally selfish. He cares nothing for the plight of others and will not let justice, the demands of God or the demands of men, affect his decisions. And there is a widow, a woman who is at the very bottom of the social ladder, and she has been wronged. The judge had no desire to hear her case and give her justice, yet she kept coming to him saying, "Give me justice against my adversary." She was so persistent, tenacious, and obstinate in her demands for justice that the judge heard her case and ruled in her favor. She would not let him rest, and the judge, for a while, refused. But afterward, he said to himself, "Though I neither fear God nor respect man, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will give her justice, so that she will not beat me down by her continual coming." The widow, in her persistent petitions, received justice from the wicked judge. The wicked judge who did not care for her and want to hear her case. The wicked judge is nothing like the God to whom we pray. While the wicked judge did not want to hear the widow's petitions, our Heavenly Father tenderly invites us to pray with all boldness and confidence and ask him as dear children ask their dear Father. The wicked judge did not care about the widow in the slightest, but God cares about his Christians so deeply that in love he predestined us for adoption to himself, as sons through Jesus Christ, and gives us redemption through his blood and the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace. If the wicked judge gave justice to the persistent widow, will not God give justice to his elect, who cry to him day and night? Certainly he will. And thus, as we journey to the heavenly city, our path is lighted by the word of God, our bellies are full of the Lord's holy supper, and we pray boldly, knowing that our Father hears our prayers, and that he will deliver us. The question is not whether or not God will be faithful, but whether when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? Whether men with itching ears will all have gone astray after false prophets, wandered off the path and lost heart. Whether the narrow road will be empty and the wide path to destruction full. And the answer to that question will be yes. The Son of Man will find faith upon the earth. Now it is true, the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching. And it seems in many ways to already be here. But the Lord is faithful even when we are faithless. He continues to seek the lost and bring us back to the path. And for this we are his instruments. For this we sojourn in this world for a while longer. The Apostle Paul exhorts us, "Preach the word, be ready in season and out of season." And Jesus says, "Let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." For this word, his gospel, is the light that shines in the darkness, and the darkness will not overcome it. It is the light, it lights the path through Christ's death and resurrection to heavenly glory. By his grace, by his power, by his word, by his supper, through the comfort of prayer, faith will endure on the earth till the end. And brothers and sisters, we forget what lies behind and strain forward to what lies ahead. We press on toward the goal for the prize of the crown of glory in Christ Jesus. Amen.